Well, happy 4th of July. My name is John Henry Richardson. I'm standing outside the Hollywood Heritage Museum. We'll be going in there shortly and showing you some fun things. And I'm going to be hosting the Firecracker Film Festival. So stay tuned for some very interesting movies.
The Firecracker Film Festival Hollywood Anniversary Special is brought to you by Archer Weiss Insurance.
My name is Mark Weiss, and we hope we can help you today.
My name is Barbara Archer, and we offer health insurance for families, individuals, Medicare, small companies, and we also offer insurance to large companies. In addition to that, we offer property and casualty insurance. Should you want a free quote, you can do so online or feel free to call our 800 number.
Archer Weiss also has and offers complete financial services for your investments and your retirement plans.
Phone Archer Weiss today at 800-831-2901 or visit them on the web.
Whether you're a business, an organization, a band, a blog, or just you, we all have and watch video. Funny video, product videos, training videos, educational video, a whole lot of video. Stop the madness. Create a TV page. Just import any video, playlist, or channel directly from YouTube. Control the experience. Organize videos around your subject with your program guide. Customize your TV page with your canvas image, logo, or photo. Share and embed. Not just one video. An entire video collection. On any site or blog. On any device. With everyone. Get yours at tvpage.com. It's free.
Well, we're standing outside the Hollywood Heritage Museum, and it wasn't always a museum. Back 100 years ago, it was known as the Lasky DeMille Barn, and this is the official birthplace of Hollywood movies. That's where the very first feature-length film was made in Hollywood. So we're actually celebrating the centennial of Hollywood as we know it today. We're here celebrating the 100th anniversary of Hollywood films. And Albert Einstein said that a human being's greatest gift is their creative imagination. Now, when I look at this miniature of the Lasky Barn, I really think about the fact that we had such humble beginnings. Who would have thought the industry would have become the most money-making industry of any in the world? Today, when they make a film at one of the major studios, it's $200 million. But back in the day, it was made for a few hundred dollars, and that was a lot. Now here you see the barn, the two buildings here, and they added on offices and wardrobe and makeup and costume areas and the editing areas over here. And what's interesting, if you look behind it, you'll see this one kind of outdoor patio area with this silk cover over the top of it, right? Kind of like a canopy. Well, that's like a silk parachute, if you will. When they were shooting by daylight, and back in those days, they didn't have lights. They just shot day. So they relied on God as the gaffer. And so they would take this sheet and they would have the sun glow through it, and that would keep the faces from having harsh shadows so you could work all day long. And then they put it on a pivot, a turnstile, so that as the sun changed position, they could change the set along with it. That's pretty ingenious. You know, America the Beautiful certainly is a signature song of 4th of July. And at tonight's Firecracker Film Festival, we're going to showcase some of that beauty, from a lovely mountain lake to the shining Pacific Ocean. We'll also pay tribute to a particular American trait, that willingness to stand apart, to follow one's own path. Now, our first film is Getting Ready for Sunday, written by Kimberly Brandon and produced by Jake Kreider. And it introduces us to Marcus Kreider, who built a life and career from his passion
for motorcycles.
Ready for Sunday is a bio about Mark Kreider and his passion for motocross and how he continues to live his dream today.
I was always telling my dad I wanted a motorcycle, I wanted to, you know, ride these things. So he thought he'd fix me real good, and he brought home one night, he brought home that tube-framed thing with little tiny wheels on it, you know, like a circus bike. It had no motor, it had two flat tires, and just a bunch of parts that didn't go to it. And he thought, well, you know, I'll fix him. I'll never get this thing running. So I looked at it, and I figured it out, and did side work. Bought a motor from a lawnmower shop and stuck it in this thing, and didn't even have like the throttle or anything on it. I ran the wire from the carburetor to the handlebar so I could pull it from. And he came home that night, and I was ripping up and down the street on this thing and making all sorts of noise and pissing off the neighbors. He was just shaking his head, just going, okay, well, game's on. We got here in 66, and it definitely was a tiny little beach community. Everything around us was hills. You know, all these track homes were hillside. As a little kid, you wandered through the hills. I think I was in grammar school when I actually figured out I was going to ride motorcycles. And watching all the big kids in the fields around, thinking, man, that is cool. I'm gonna do that. I just started going down to the motorcycle shop, one of the motorcycle shops downtown, hanging around, poking around down there, asking questions, you know, until they threw me out. And then looking at magazines and reading everything about all the cool stuff. And you just start from there. You know, school was always a struggle for me in a lot of respects, and the structure, rigid structure of it all, and it is because it is, and that's all you need to know. If I got decent grades, meaning I didn't fail, then he'd help me buy a motorcycle of some sort. It's a good outlet for a lot of us. But my parents were totally against motorcycles to begin with, because motorcycles were bikers. Bikers were bad. So, you know, they had no clue as to what was going on in the world of racing and whatnot. Kept us busy, kept us out of trouble for the most part, you know, and we didn't have a lot of peer pressure, because, you know, when peer pressure comes down on the weaker people that don't have a focus, you know. So, but plus, you know, when we were younger, it was only a handful of guys could do it, you know. So that was kind of cool too, because that made us special. We weren't ball players in high school or whatever, you know, we weren't those guys, but we still got a little bit of respect from people who understood how hard it was when they'd watch a motorcycle race and go, oh, you guys are nuts. But it was completely relative to us. Getting hurt, you know, break a leg, no big deal. We'll heal up, we'll be back. The reality was different for us than what people perceived. It gave you a lot of confidence. So I got a TM125 Suzuki that my dad bought because it was like a couple hundred bucks cheaper than the Honda Elsinore. That was my first real dedicated motocross bike. I was gonna be the next somebody, you know? I was like, I wanna do this for a living. There was a ritual that, you know, after the race is Monday, you start tearing the bike down. And you go through the service and you check all your frames not cracked, your wheels aren't broken, all that, all the way to during the week you'd be riding your bicycle or running or running on the beach or something, just to, because we thought that's what you were supposed to do. And it wasn't as regimented as it is now. So, but these were all the things we did during the week to get ready for Sunday, which was the big race day. That was the main goal, was collecting trophies. And then when you got into the pro ranks and you got a purse, you got the percentage of the gate. If you could make your expenses and some gas money for the next week, then that was cool. Trying to work your way to the national level where then you actually get a paycheck and stuff. But that wasn't in the cards for me. So I started moving more and got into the bicycle industry, of all things. But it was a way for me to take what I learned from motorcycles into this new thing called mountain bikes, and started working for bicycle companies and designing and speccing bicycles and traveling the world. And then I got to actually go race and go race the nationals and go do the whole tour. Everything I had designed for myself in motorcycles, I ended up fulfilling in bicycles. What really brought me back here was my parents passing. Mom died first. She made me promise that I'd watch after Dad, you know, keep an eye. So we worked our way back down to Mission Viejo, and I kept an eye on Pop, and we had the best, probably the best last 3 years that he and I ever had. We just bonded really well, and then he passed. So when he passed, then we moved all the way back to San Clemente. I realized that all those years I was traveling around, I never really felt like I unpacked my suitcase for all these years. It was just like I was on a business trip. And then when I got back here, it just, like a big exhale. I was like, wow, that's cool. Okay, now I can get back to my life. So San Clemente was always home, and I just didn't know it when I was living here, you know, as a kid. Just a few years ago, some friends of mine talked me into restoring an old Suzuki 400 from the late 70s. So I thought, you know, that's a good project, something to do, and that got me hooked. And then it was like, oh man, these old bikes, you know. We started looking at things I used to have or couldn't have when I was younger. So, you know, you find them for a couple $100 and they're in terrible shape, and you bring them back to life. And the whole transition from hunting it down, finding it, getting all the parts, which is a pain, and then, you know, to something like that where it actually is presentable and raceable. You know, some guys would rather just buy a restored motorcycle. And, you know, it's all well and good if you got the money and you have no real passion, but most of us like to take it from the ground up, you know, redo the frame, go through the motor, use skills we haven't used for a long time. The 500 was a horrible mess. It was two different motorcycles like this that I patched together and made one out of. So when I take that out on the track, I feel good about it because, you know, I know what went into making that thing run again, bringing it back to life.
All right, we're looking at the first plaque that was put up outside of the Hollywood Heritage Museum in 1956 when they moved it. This was originally at the corner of Thelma and Hollywood Boulevard off of Vine. And that's why Hollywood and Vine is considered the center of Hollywood. This old barn was rented for a short period of time, and they shot their first film here, their first feature film ever made in Hollywood in 1913, called The Squaw Man. It was directed by Cecil B. DeMille, the great epic filmmaker who made such movies as Samson and Delilah and The Ten Commandments. Jesse Lasky was his partner. Lasky became Paramount Studios, the very first film studio here in Hollywood, and still exists today. What you notice up here is a photograph of all these cameramen at MGM in the late 1920s. They have their hand on the crank to advance the film. So the key to be a good cameraman in those days is to be able to advance at exactly 24 frames a second.
Fascinating, huh? Little film cans that they came in.
It was a hand crank home projector.
Yep.
Override it. They're not
not doing that now. It felt good. It's just smooth. And I saw you sliding into some of the turns.
I was able to wind it up and back into the corners. Like,
yeah.
Like Superman.
It's definitely coming.
All the kids would sit around in the parlor, and you'd feed that through there and see the result. Your film can be included in next year's Firecracker Film Festival. Just visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com for details.
The Firecracker Film Festival, Hollywood Anniversary Edition, including thesis films from Cal State Northridge, is being brought to you by Archer Weiss Insurance and Financial Services. Give them a call at 800-831-2901.
My name is Mark Weiss, and we hope we can help you today.
My name is Barbara Archer, and we offer health insurance for families, individuals, Medicare, small companies, and we also offer insurance to large companies. In addition to that, we offer property and casualty insurance. Should you want a free quote, you can do so online or feel free to call our 800 number.
Archer Weiss also has and offers complete financial services for your investments and your retirement plans.
Phone Archer Weiss today at 800-831-2901 or visit them on the web.
Independence.
Liberty.
The pursuit of happiness.
These are principles that are important to us at the LJR Arts Academy in San Bernardino. By providing free and minimal cost programs in
dance,
acting,
film production,
so that everyone can be free to express themselves through art.
Happy 4th of July!
Now, this year's films are thesis documentaries produced under the auspices of the California State University of Northridge for the Cinema and Television Arts Departments. The supervising producer, Thelma Vickroy. As Americans, we always enjoy the wonders of the great outdoors, but we don't always give enough thought to protecting those resources that provide us with such pleasure. The Problem with Perfection is shot at beautiful Lake Tahoe and explores the need to balance our desire to pursue independent passions with the need to appreciate and preserve the natural resources in our care. It was written by Leah Leon, directed by David Raphael, and produced by Joy Rossella.
I definitely believe that people should put a lot more effort into seeing how beautiful this place is because it is absolutely breathtaking.
We are part of the land. We are the land. You know, we are the people. Land is us. Our creation story says that we were created here in this country, Washoe Country. We have always been here. We didn't come from any other place. It's the first thing we did when we came here is come to the water and bless ourselves and bless the lake because it was a giver of life. It fed the animals, the birds, the plants, humans. It was very precious to us.
Well, the lake's always been important to the tribe, and it goes back thousands of years. You know, our history tells us we've been here from the beginning. So our tie and connection to the land goes back a long ways. Every Washoe viewed the lake as the most sacred place of all the tribe. Well, the tribe's always concerned about the health of the lake, and I think it goes back since contact. And when I mean contact, that's when the non-native types moved into the area and they immediately started to alter the environment. And when they altered the environment, it had bad effects to the lake and the environment. And so, you know, we've always had concerns about it, and it's still important to the tribe.
The League to Save Lake Tahoe started in 1957 when a group of concerned citizens saw the potential for rampant overdevelopment happening here in the basin. Some examples would be there was a proposal for a multi-lane high-speed freeway that would circle the entire lake, including a giant bridge to span Emerald Bay here behind us, which would alter the look and feel of Tahoe forever. They additionally wanted to have casino areas around the entire lake and large urban development. And people saw that this could potentially impact the lake for now and into the future. And so they were able to successfully persuade public opinion to not develop those projects. And that was really the seed that started this nonprofit, which is the League to Save Lake Tahoe. The League focuses on protecting Lake Tahoe for this and future generations, with the primary focus being water quality and the clarity of this pristine lake behind us. That's sort of the indicator to determine how Lake Tahoe is doing.
Tahoe is losing its clarity for a multitude of reasons. So the main one currently is very fine particles. I mean, what's changed in the lake in the last 40 or 50 years is that we have a much larger built environment. We have roadways and parking lots and houses, which is fine. The bad thing is that when rain or snow falls on those, it moves very quickly once it melts, and it goes directly into the lake, and it carries with it all these fine particles, this clay and this silt. Before this development, all that would have soaked into the ground, but now that ground is asphalt and concrete. So what we're working with many of the agencies here is to try to re-engineer the basin. How can we intercept these fine particles before they get to the lake? Tahoe Keys was probably the largest single piece of bad development that was done here. It's an area that was built in the 1960s as a housing development, and you could drive your boat right up to your front door. It used to be the largest natural marsh in the whole Sierra Nevada. So the Upper Truckee River, every year when it would flood into this marsh, and the marsh would remove pollutants, sediment from the river. Now those pollutants go straight out into the lake.
I can't speak for all the tribal members, but I know there's been times where a lot of tribal members don't even want to come to the lake because of what they see. And it's disheartening to a lot of people. It's disheartening to me because all our prime real estate was gobbled up. You know, just people, you know, they just came in here by the thousands during the gold rush. And then in the silver rush, they came back through in an equal amount of thousands. So it was very quick that they took over the lands, and we were just kind of pushed aside. And, you know, I guess that's about it.
Well, there have been no chemicals added into the lake. It's actually, there's a lot of environmental regulation here, but one of the strongest and most strict is that you cannot add any chemical into the lake. So many lakes around the world, they do add chemicals for various reasons. Here, nothing's happened. So what's been added is what flows in from the streams and the drains around the lake. There have also been biology added to the lake. So sometimes they're referred to as invasive species. These would be species that didn't live here naturally. Some of them were deliberately added to the lake, often for good reasons. Unfortunately, the knowledge at the time wasn't as advanced as we would have liked, or as what they thought they had. So we have these invasive species that have actually changed the food web, and they're one of the biggest threats. So the deliberately introduced species, and increasingly now these species that may come in on people's boats, or people dump things from their aquariums at the end of summer. So this is something that's starting to have a large impact on the ecology of the lake.
The biggest threat, you know, in the simplest terms, is human impacts and all the things that come along with that. Development of roads, buildings, all the activities we like to do here, like skiing, boating. All of those have an impact on Lake Tahoe. But at the League, we realize that, you know, there has to be a balance between sort of the human uses and appreciating this beautiful place, and then also the impact we leave behind. So what we try and do is let people know the things that they can do on their everyday activities or when they come to visit Lake Tahoe to help minimize their impact. Because it's not just the impact of one person, but the cumulative impact of everybody that comes here. And it's just sort of bringing that awareness to everyone's forefront of people's minds and making sure they're thinking about the beautiful Tahoe that brought them here, making sure it's here for their kids and future generations to see.
The biggest threat to the lake, me, you, people. We really are it. But we're not going away, and we shouldn't have to go away. And that's the issue of how can we change the way we live, the way we build things, to better protect the environment.
If I had complete power over the lake, I'd probably have to get rid of quite a few roads, quite a few developments, you know, just change people's attitude about the lake is that, you know, they have to live within this environment and they need to keep it clean. It's just, you know, that's the way the Washoe people have lived up here for thousands of years, is they understood that we needed this environment, and the people now view it as a playground or whatever, but you know, there's that. I think that would be it.
I'm John Henry Richardson at the Hollywood Heritage Museum. The silent film period began in 1895. By 1913, we were making films in Hollywood. And by 1927, the silent film period was over. And it was over because Warner Brothers invented sound films. John Gilbert was the number one movie star in all of the world. And he's holding that disc, introducing it over at MGM, as if to say, look, there's a new technology. Well, what he didn't realize is that this little disc would be the demise of his career. Because John Gilbert had a very high-pitched, very much like a tenor voice. His voice was too squeaky and too loud. And the way he found out that his voice didn't work is he made a film. It was screened at the Chinese theater in Hollywood. He went to the Chinese theater, sat in the audience, and when the lights dimmed and the movie came on, and he walked on screen and he started saying his lines, people in the audience, one by one, started laughing at him. And he didn't understand why. And by the end of that screening of that movie on that night, John Gilbert's career was over. We're here celebrating the 100th anniversary of Hollywood films. And what better place to celebrate than here at the Hollywood Heritage Museum? If you haven't visited, you can go online right now to the Hollywood Heritage Museum and learn all about it. Pretty fascinating place, and see where it all began. Stay with us as we go from Lake Tahoe to some of California's favorite beaches, and later we'll visit a different kind of locale entirely and go back in time to do it.
The Firecracker Film Festival Hollywood Anniversary Special is brought to you by Archer Weiss Insurance.
My name is Mark Weiss, and we hope we can help you today.
My name is Barbara Archer, and we offer health insurance for families, individuals, Medicare, small companies, and we also offer insurance to large companies. In addition to that, we offer property and casualty insurance. Should you want a free quote, you can do so online or feel free to call our 800 number.
Archer Weiss also has and offers complete financial services for your investments and your retirement plans.
Phone Archer Weiss today at 800 831-2901 or visit them on the web.
Your film can be included in next year's Firecracker Film Festival. Just visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com for details.
Whether you're a business, an organization, a band, a blog, or just you, we all have and watch video. Funny video, product videos, training videos, educational video, a whole lot of video. Stop the madness. Create a TV page. Just import any video, playlist, or channel directly from YouTube. Control the experience. Organize videos around your subject with your program guide. Customize your TV page with your canvas image, logo, or photo. Share and embed. Not just one video, an entire video collection on any site or blog, on any device, with everyone. Get yours at tvpage.com. It's free.
I'm John Henry Richardson at the Hollywood Heritage Museum. What happens when our desire to explore our natural resort areas comes in direct conflict with another form of life? Is it possible that through careful study, the needs of all can be met? Shot mainly on the open beaches of San Luis Obispo County, the snowy plover examines the controversy surrounding the plight of a species of small bird and what's being done to try to provide a remedy. The film was written by David Gonzalez and called in Sherry Quinnell. Jerry Penales was director of photography.
It is at 3:20 on News Talk 920 KVC. Welcome back. I'm Dave Congleton. What do you think about this ongoing, what I would call the battle for the beach? That is, the state parks is saying we need to protect the snowy plover, and for years they've been restricting more and more of Central Coast Beach. At the same time, there are those of you who like to walk your dogs in the dunes, on the beach. There are also many of you that enjoy driving your vehicles on the beach. How do we balance out the rights of dog lovers and off-road vehicle people with those of you who want to protect the snowy plover? Are you aware of this controversy at all?
No. I don't think I've even seen one of these birds.
You did? Because they're hiding.
The western snowy plover has been living here since before European contact in California. It used to be very widespread up and down most sandy beaches in California. And, you know, over the course of time, and certainly with human occupation on these beaches, the snowy plover numbers have decreased a fair amount. And the reason is because these birds like to nest in the same places that we like to go during the summer. They want to nest on these open, wide, sandy beaches, and they nest during the summertime from March through September when we like to be on the beaches. And so if you think of some of the iconic beaches in California, including in Southern California, you think of Zuma, you think of Dockweiler, you think of Hermosa Beach, Huntington Beach, all of these places were formerly fabulous breeding habitat for western snowy plover, but because so many people go to these beaches, they've blinked out from these areas. And so really it's a story about how humans and human recreational use has impacted formerly, you know, fairly abundant native species in California.
All right, we got Larry in Santa Margarita on KVEC. Hey, Larry.
Hey, guys. Hi. Interesting conversation.
What would you say, Larry?
Well, you know, we have this thing called natural selection. And some animals die off just because they're not worthy to survive. They can't survive in the environment, and so they die off. Maybe it's just time for the snowy plover to go away, you know, and it just can't seem to survive in the environment.
Man, Larry, you're harsh.
Well, this has been going on for millions of years, supposedly, yeah. And if something can't survive, it goes away and, you know, is replaced by something else.
Well, I can't really describe the exact boundaries, but I know you used to be able to drive all the way down the coast, I remember, till at least Guadalupe or further probably, and they blocked that off quite some time ago. The other areas of the dunes have been blocked off a long, long time ago also, and it just makes it a lot more difficult. They open up certain areas once in a while for certain moments of time, and then they close them, and it makes things even more confusing because they're always changing things and always making it very difficult to enjoy just nature and go out there and have a good time.
You know, I can't really see how a leashed dog can contribute to the decline of the plover. It seems like the more laws and restrictions that go into effect, the less people choose to pick our area to actually visit as a recreation area. It just kind of puts a damper on a lot of events that people would normally partake in, especially in our, you know, state beaches, which we have a lot of places to really go and explore and play.
The snowy plover doesn't know that your dog, doesn't know the difference between your dog and a coyote or a fox. They see a four-legged canine coming up and they perceive your dog as a predator.
They're putting more and more restrictions on things and making it harder and harder to live and maintain a happy, happy life, you know? What are they going to do? Tell us that we have to put leashes on our children next because they're going to get run over by vehicles or quads, or, you know, you have to not have your children out there anymore. You know, people won't be able to go out there and enjoy it eventually in the future generations to come if they keep putting these many restrictions and limitations on things. And I don't really think that's fair.
We close off a large portion of our park, about 300 acres. And when I say close, that means nobody goes in. They don't go on the beach in front of this area. We have a 6-foot tall fence to keep out predators and humans. It's really a no man's land.
If you have species that are dying off, something's wrong. You know, they're kind of our canary in the cage.
What I would say, though, is that possibly another way to look at it is one of the issues, my understanding is that the plover will only nest on open sand sheets. And one of the problems with our open sand sheets is that there's so much ice plant and so much European dune grass that's been planted over the years to stop the sand from blowing, that's really encroached on the snowy plover's habitat. So it might be more effective to get rid of, and I know it's an expensive, difficult process, but it might be a better plan to get rid of all the non-native plants that are hampering the snowy plover.
Interesting.
The Oceano Dunes State Recreation Area has a far higher fledgling success rate than the National Wildlife Refuge, which is just to the south. I think what we need to be doing is looking at why that is. And part of that reason is the off-road vehicle use provides $6,000 per nest to send people out with night vision to look for predators, to tag chicks, which Oceano Dunes is the only place in the country that has a tagging program. The other problem, and really the real problem, is the infestation of Ammophila arenaria, otherwise known as European dune grass, which crowds out the plover. The plover likes open sand. And we need to look at a vegetation eradication program to remove these invasives that are destroying habitat.
Ah, now there's a possible solution. Remove the invasive vegetation.
They do not like cover. They like open nesting areas. And that dune grass has destroyed a lot of habitat for the plover. Coming up on the horizon, the Air Pollution Control District wants to plant more vegetation on the beach, which will further degrade plover habitat. So we need to look at what's going right there, apply it elsewhere, and be very careful about planting more vegetation. I'd like to see vegetation removed. that kind of money is only generated through the use of that park as we have now.
You know, I like the environment and I like animals. I love them. But we're here to enjoy the nature and enjoy what we have. And we can't do that when they're telling us that we can't go in certain areas and we eventually are not going to be able to even get on the beach if they keep up at this pace of what they're doing. I think they should ease up, have certain restrictions that are for our safety and for, you know, everyone else's safety, so everyone can have a good, happy time and fun time doing it and enjoying it.
I don't think we should ban anything completely. I don't think we should ban dogs off a beach. I don't think we should ban off-the-road vehicles off the beach, nor do we at the same time throw a snowy plover under the bus. All right? There's got to be a way that everybody can enjoy the beach in some way, shape, or form. That's my argument. Dogs have a right to be there. People on off-the-road vehicles have a right to drive there. But by all means, if snowy plover is in danger, we got to do something about that.
You're looking at a very, very old light board. And back in the heyday of Hollywood filmmaking in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, this is how they would be able to light vast sound stages. They could hang lights all over the place. And by just moving these levers, they could then change the nuance, the very subtle style of lighting from a shot to shot to shot. That's what made Hollywood movies seem like magic. What we're looking at here is a three-strip Technicolor camera, the very first camera that was used to make Technicolor films back in the 1930s. And if you look closely, you'll see three separate strips of film. That's how they had to make films back in those days. Movies like Gone with the Wind and Wizard of Oz were shot with this camera. Now, when we come back, we will welcome you to Old Sodbury, where three village losers will take us on an adventure to rescue a fair maiden.
My name is Mark Weiss, and we hope we can help you today.
My name is Barbara Archer, and we offer health insurance for families, individuals, Medicare, small companies, and we also offer insurance to large companies. In addition to that, we offer property and casualty insurance. Should you want a free quote, you can do so online or feel free to call our 800 number.
Archer Weiss also has and offers complete financial services for your investments and your retirement plans.
Phone Archer Weiss today at 800-831-2901 or visit them on the web.
Whether you're a business, an organization, a band, a blog, or just you, we all have and watch video. Funny video, product videos, training videos, educational video, a whole lot of video. Stop the madness. Create a TV page. Just import any video, playlist, or channel directly from YouTube. Control the experience. Organize videos around your subject with your program guide. Customize your TV page with your canvas image, logo, or photo. Share and embed. Not just one video, an entire video collection on any site or blog, on any device, with everyone. Get yours at tvpage.com. It's free.
Your film can be included in next year's Firecracker Film Festival. Just visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com for details. I'm John Henry Richardson at the Hollywood Heritage Museum. Well, we're here celebrating the 100th anniversary of Hollywood films. We end our Firecracker Film Festival by celebrating a different kind of freedom. Freedom to imagine. and, with a lot of hard work, create a place where no one's ever been. Old Sodbury was produced by Vanessa Carr and Devin Bradbury, directed by Imran Sheikh, and written by Michael Holcomb.
I can get anything for you. Whips, chains, leather.
One wonders what side of the pasture you tend to.
Like it, laugh. It's supposed to be funny. Tell everybody to watch Old Sodbury.
You see that there, Aldous? That is a bicep. Greater than the loin of an elephant. Maybe one day, when you're done with your apprenticeship and you have a large sum of money, a little touch of wizardry, you too can one day be like... What am I saying? Not a chance. Aha! Women folk!
Oh, Brutus, you left cabbage so well.
Hold my things. May I carry your things?
I think carrying that big head of yours around is enough. Don't you? Come on, Marielle, we've got to get to the tailor shop at once.
I think I'll stay and watch Brutus. He's so gorgeous when he's angry.
As you wish. Goodbye, Aldous.
He sounds very nice. You're a very lucky girl, Hazel.
Well, I would hope so. We spent a good shilling on the best matchmaker in the kingdom.
My heart longs for another.
Here are the wedding garments, ma'am. It's quite a hassle getting them across the border. The Morguls can be such savages.
But they do make the finest silks.
Thank you for bringing the silks. Just for me.
Anything for a friend.
I made this for you. For when you travel dangerously.
Oh, a knife. Thank you. I should have used it on Brutus earlier. He made another spectacle today in the market. Well, anyway, I've got to get off. Thanks again, ladies. And thank you tenfold for the present.
I can get anything for you. Swords, whips, chains, leather.
Okay.
Anything.
Oh, dear Hazel, one wonders what side of the pasture you tend to.
This one is supposed to make you invisible. It contains 6 beard hairs from dwarven elves, dragonberries, and just a dash of horse piss.
Dragonberries? Gross. Can you make me a potion that'll stop me from marrying Sir Cromwell?
Or a potion that can melt hearts?
I did that once, back in Old Country. It literally melted her heart. Technically, it worked.
Oh, Aldous! Where's your cousin Brutus and his rippling chest and strong jaw and powerful hands? Oh, sorry. Evil King Morgul's men have crossed into town and taken my friend Amelia. They've accused her of stealing silks. We need a hero to save her.
Who needs Brutus? You've got us.
I said a hero. No time for games. Brutus!
We mustn't act rash. The Morgul border is very dangerous at night. I say we wait until daybreak.
Sir Cromwell, Commissioner of Sodbury Commerce, is correct. The border is far too threatening at night, even for the greatest knight, like myself.
Aye!
With the best combat skills, like myself.
Aye!
With the silkiest, creamiest, baby-smooth skin, like myself.
Aye?
What the? Did that make everyone invisible?
Men! This is Sodbury! Gather your weapons! Pay respect to your loved ones and meet in the courtyard. We ride at the stroke of the first cock's crow.
Aye!
Pass the salt.
Well, it looks like the men can handle it from here.
Aldous Merryfeather Dingleworth the third stop right there.
I've seen the way Amelia looks at you. And I know you have feelings for her too, just as I do. But think about how grateful she'll be. Think about it.
Oh, they throw you a parade.
Oh, yeah. Build you a statue in the terrace.
Yeah.
An epic wedding with the most beautiful woman in the entire kingdom. Yeah.
Oh, they'd write ballads about us. Off to adventure, the brave friends three. Aldous, Hazel, the handsome Beasley.
Beasley. Okay.
Friends, this is our time to show the world. We may not have big muscles or working potions.
Hey.
Or bags of gold.
Real jobs.
Or good jawbones.
Or testicles. But we can teach the village that you don't need all of that to do great things. Now, let's gather our weapons and go save Amelia!
Yeah! Oh. That was my bad. Hey, no one's gonna think this is a lady's purse, do you think?
Where's Aldous?
Let's do this. That doesn't look so bad.
Read the sign! Ignorance will not be tolerated!
Second thought?
I say we charge him and bust through.
No. We're outnumbered. We need to think of a plan or something. I think I've got it. My invisibility potion.
That didn't work, Bees.
Yeah, because I forgot the most important ingredient. The hemorrhoid of a black mountain goat.
I'm not even gonna ask where you get these ingredients.
Dragonberries.
Hey guys, I think it worked. Am I invisible?
Hemorrhoids. It was the hemorrhoids.
Now, let's sneak quietly through the gate when they let the next group of people in, okay?
Sounds easy enough, right, Bees?
Hemorrhoids!
Excuse me. It's wearing off.
I can see you too!
Behead them!
Not today!
Rise and shine.
I suppose we've gone too far to turn back now.
Aldous, look what I found. I gave this to Amelia the day she was kidnapped. I think she left it behind as a message.
I have something for that. Many fairies gave their life for this dust. Yes, this way. It's really foggy all of a sudden.
Hey,
Hollywood Heritage Museum is located in the parking lot across from the entrance of the Hollywood Bowl on Highland, right off the 101 freeway.
That's why they were called, these were called penny arcades, because that's all you had to spend was a penny to have a good time. And you put your penny in here and you crank this, and for about 50 seconds, you'd be able to look in here and watch a movie. And that's how it all began.
They delivered back to you and you'd take it home, and all the kids would sit around in the parlor and you'd feed that through there and see the result of the day that you spent at the beach or wherever you were.
And if you look closely, you'll see three separate strips of film. That's how they had to make films back in those days. Since then, they've developed a Technicolor process where they only need one piece of film. This year's films are thesis films produced under the auspices of the California State University of Northridge, Department of Cinema and Television Arts. Supervising producer, Thelma Vickroy.
Your film can be included in next year's Firecracker Film Festival. Just visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com for details.
Off to adventure, the brave friends three. Aldous, Hazel, the handsome Beasley.
Beasley. Okay.
That was my bad.
Well, that just about wraps it up for this year's Firecracker Film Festival. Now, if you're thinking about making a film of your own, well, you can enter it by going online to thefirecrackerfilmfestival.com. Think about it. I'm John Henry Richardson at the Hollywood Heritage Museum. Have a happy and safe 4th of July.
Thank you for watching the Firecracker Film Festival. And if you're not through watching or you want to see one of these great movies again, visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com for the replay of the show and the contact information of the filmmaker. We'd like to thank everybody at Cal State Northridge, including Thelma Vickroy, Quinn Saunders, and the chair of the department, Jon Stahl. We'd like to thank our host, John Henry Richardson, and the writers, Pat Trimmer and John Henry Richardson, our location producer, Karen Greenwood, animation man, Mike Davis, and all the Northridge filmmakers who made this year's show possible. Visit the Hollywood Heritage Museum when you get a chance, and visit these websites for more cool historic pictures. I'm Tim Greenwood. Thanks for watching the Firecracker Film Festival. For more information about entering your film, visit firecrackerfilmfestival.com.
Whether you're a business, an organization, a band, a blog, or just you, we all have and watch video. Funny video, product videos, training videos, educational video, a whole lot of video. Stop the madness. Create a TV page. Just import any video, playlist, or channel directly from YouTube. Control the experience. Organize videos around your subject with your program guide. Customize your TV page with your canvas image, logo, or photo. Share and embed. Not just one video. An entire video collection. On any site or blog. On any device. With everyone. Get yours at tvpage.com. It's free.
My name is Mark Weiss, and we hope we can help you today.
My name is Barbara Archer, and we offer health insurance for families, individuals, Medicare, small companies, and we also offer insurance to large companies. In addition to that, we offer property and casualty insurance. Should you want a free quote, you can do so online, or feel free to call our 800 number.
Archer Weiss also has and offers complete financial services for your investments and your retirement plans.
Phone Archer Weiss today at 800-831-2901 or visit them on the web.